So now we are getting into the fifth module or the last module, and it is about transmission lines. Okay, so let us see what we are going to learn. So till now, what we were learning? Till now we were learning the electromagnetic wave propagation, right? Electromagnetic wave propagation, we have covered one module with that. In what? In the unbounded medium, right? In the unbounded medium. Okay, or media. Why I am saying that? We were considering things like if you have a dielectric medium or if you have a different dielectric media, how the electromagnetic wave will travel, or even we have seen the propagation constant and all, right? So those all things we have already seen in terms of different parameters for unbounded medium. So basically, where we are using this electromagnetic wave, we are using it for different purposes, like for communication, right? You know that whatever TV sets you have, the information to the TV set that is coming with electromagnetic wave propagation, or it is used for different purposes. When in unbounded media, an example is this communication lines and all, from antenna to antenna, or in such cases where people your information or whatever wave you have, it is spread in the media, and you if you need it, you can use an antenna to capture it, right? You use an antenna to capture it. So that they are examples for what? The unbounded media examples, and that is what we have dealt with till now. Let us see about a bounded medium. Okay, now let us see about a bounded medium. It is like we want to communicate, but from a source to a particular load. That is a case when we are speaking about the bounded medium, and such electromagnetic propagation in bounded medium. If I say we have got a source like this, and what, we have got a load also, and in between them we have to transmit information or power. We may be transferring information or we might be transferring power. In any case, we will be using what? Two or more cable lines to do that. In a bounded medium means the transmission can be in two ways. For a bounded medium, it can be either through transmission lines, something you are familiar with. Being electrical engineers, we know how we transmit power from the generating station to our houses or the loads. And there is another kind, which is the waveguides. Okay, we are not learning waveguides here because it is not that important for you. Instead, we are learning transmission lines in electromagnetics. And transmission line means we are connecting, as I just said earlier, we are connecting a source and load with a two or more transmission line. Okay, transmission line means we are connecting a source and load. We have a source and we have a load. Okay, we have a source and we have a load, and in between them you can connect or transmit information or power. We can transmit information or power using our transmission line. Okay, two or more. So this is an example, like this source. What we mean by source is that this source, it can be a hydroelectric generator. It can be a hydroelectric generator, or it can be something else also. Like it is your transmitter, and this is your receiver, and this is your, or it can be a hydroelectric generator, or here it can be your house or any electrical load. So this is the way we transmit power or the electrical energy. Okay, or energy from one place to another using transmission line. And there are several examples of transmission lines like this. Okay, these are different types of transmission lines that we use to transmit power. First one you are quite familiar with is what? The coaxial cable. Okay, this is a coaxial cable kind of transmission. Okay, coaxial cable. We use it in several places, like in electrical laboratory and all, we use coaxial cables. Or several other places also, like in communication channels, if you see like connecting from a TV set to the its router, or in such cases also we use coaxial cable. Then the most common one for an electrical engineer is what? Our two wire line. Right, that's something we are using in our power distribution systems, the two wire line, that is another one, the most common one. Then this parallel play configuration also we use sometimes, right? The parallel play combination, and in between use a dielectric. So that kind is there. Then another one is this, what a rod under a plane, such kind of a under a plane kind of a transmission line case. And the last one, this is the micro strip line. Okay, this is the micro strip line, and in case of micro strip line, this is specifically used in integrated circuits. Okay, this is specifically used in integrated circuits.
The problems in transmission lines, the problems on transmission lines, we can solve in two ways. One is using what electromagnetic theory, another one is based on the circuit theory. Okay, circuit theory means what you have defined the resistance, inductance, capacitance of terms already, I think, and we know how voltage and current behaves for each of those elements. So such a mathematical model we can use to solve transmission line problems. At the same time, we can see we can solve it using electromagnetic theory also, like the electric field and the magnetic field in terms of these quantities. Okay, mostly circuit theory is more simple, right? It is more simple and convenient to use a mathematical model rather than mathematical and quite simple model, rather than going for what our electromagnetic field theory. So that's about that, and even with that also, it is always about what is our interest. Okay, what is our interest to in finding out. Okay, so that matters. Anyhow, let us see this transmission line parameters into more. So if you take a transmission line, okay, so this is an example of a transmission line. Let us take like a two wire transmission line. If you take, okay, if you are taking a two wire transmission line, then it is something like this, right? So it is something like this. You have let us say that you have two wires. Okay, you have the two wires like this. You have a two wire line, and that you can represent as a distributed line. You know that your resistance, inductance and capacitance of the transmission line, or even the conductance, they are all distributed all along the transmission line. It is not like at a particular point, and that is a reality. So they are not discrete. This line parameters, they are not discrete. They are not discrete or lumped. They are not lumped or discrete. And what they are distributed. Okay, so they are distributed all along the transmission line. So that is what is represented here. So when you have the two wire line, you know that it is having a resistance as well as inductance. There is no doubt about that. You have a conductor, and you have your voltage or current flowing through it. So you have both resistance as well as inductance attached to it, right? That is with the transmission line itself. Now for a two wire line, let us say that you have a medium in between that. You have a medium like dielectric in between the two wires. Then what? Then you have got capacitance also. Then this conductance G, it is different from the resistance, or it is something different from the resistance associated with the line. It is about the medium that we are talking about. What is the conductivity of the dielectric medium that we have in between the transmission line? So that is represented by the conductance G and then the capacitance C as well. So we have four parameters here: R, L, G and C, right? This is the resistance of the line, this is the inductance of the transmission line, G is what the conductance that comes between the two transmission lines, and C is the capacitance of this medium that comes in between. So these are the parameters that in terms of which we represent the transmission lines, right? So that is what is the need for our transmission line parameters. These are the transmission line parameters: resistance, inductance and conductance and capacitance. Okay, now you know how it is distributed also, right? So this is a representation of the transmission line in a distributed manner for all this parameter. Okay, so basically, so this lines, when I say R, L, G and C, these are characterized by what? the conductance of this conducting material, right? The conductance of this conducting material. Then when I say inductance, it is about the permeability of the this conductor mu c, I can say. Then it is also about what the permittivity of the medium in between, right? The permittivity of the medium that comes in between. So these are the things. Okay, so these are the things that matters. You know that epsilon c will be equal to what? Epsilon zero means what? The conductance of the conductor, that will permittivity of the conductor will be always equal to epsilon zero, and it is also characterized by what? This medium that is coming in between. So that also will have impedance, conductivity mu, as well as what? The permittivity. That also will determine what? Like this sigma will determine g, this epsilon will determine what? The capacitance in between the transmission line. So these are the parameters of this transmission line, and here we discuss. And when you are having such a line, then you know that LC, the product of inductance and capacitance, will be equal to what? Mu epsilon. This is already derived, I think, in the last module. Or you can write G by C will be equal to what? Sigma by epsilon. So this is all relationship that you can see. Okay, so now before getting into the transmission line equation and all, let us first see how electromagnetic wave propagation happens for a two-conductor transmission line. Okay, so in this case of two-conductor transmission line, let us consider a coaxial cable. Okay, let us consider a coaxial cable here. Coaxial cable means what? You have two conductors, one above the other, right? So that is coaxial cable. So let me say that this is the inner conductor, and above that you have your outer conductor as well. Okay, above that you have your outer conductor as well. So this way you have your coaxial cable, and to this coaxial cable I am connecting a source. Okay, to this coaxial cable I am connecting a source like this, and it is what? Connected between this thing. Similarly, on the other side I am connecting it with what? The load resistance. Okay, so this is my coaxial cable, this is the supply, and this is what? This is the source resistance, you can say. And you have a coaxial cable like this. So this is where you have your coaxial cable. So if you have made this connection, and let us say I have a switch here like this, and I am closing in this switch in order to get the current flowing I. So what can we understand here? So when I am establishing a potential here, let me say this is positive and this is negative. So I can say that the inner conductor will have a positive polarity, and the outer conductor will have a negative polarity. Right, the inner conductor here, it will have a positive polarity, and the outer conductor will have a negative polarity. Let me say, I am connecting like this. So in this case, if we take the cross section of the coaxial cable, you can see that the inner conductor, let me say this is the inner conductor and it is positive, and you have an outer conductor, and since it is a coaxial cable, and this is what? This is the negative part, right? So that is how it will look. And since this is positive and this is negative, how your electric field is going to be? Your electric field will be pointing outward from what? The positive to negative. Like this, your electric field will be confined inside this coaxial cable, right? So this is the way your electric field is going to be, right? So that is electric field. Now similarly, when I am switching on the supply, and let me say that current is flowing in this direction, okay, and that way I am telling that in this paper your current is going inward, in the inward direction. In that case, what will be the direction of the magnetic field? You, as per Ampere's circuital law and all, you know that what will be the Ampere magnetic field. It will, the H will be encircling the conductor, right? It will be encircling the conductor. So say if you are using the right hand rule, then if you place your thumb in the direction of the conductor, the direction of encirclement of your fingers will give you the magnetic field density direction. So that way I can say that my magnetic field density is in what? In the clockwise direction. Right. My magnetic field intensity will be in the clockwise direction, like this. Right. So this way you will have magnetic field density in which direction? In the encircling direction, like this. Right. So that is about the magnetic field. Now you can observe here is that your electric field intensity E and H, both of this fields, they are what? They are perpendicular to each other, right? They are perpendicular to each other. And you have studied the pointing theorem and the pointing vector. So P is given by what? P is given by E cross H, right? So the cross product of E and H, that will be in a direction perpendicular to it will be in a direction perpendicular to both the electric and magnetic fields, right? So in this case, if you take your pointing vector will be in which direction? E is in this direction and H is in this direction. So your pointing vector P will be what? In this direction, right? Or perpendicular to the plane containing the both E and S, that will be the direction in which your electromagnetic wave propagates, right? So electromagnetic wave propagates in this direction, I can say. Or let us take it like this, like your if this is the XY plane, this is the XY plane, in the radial direction you have an electric field, and as in the circular direction parallel to the XY plane, you have got your H also. So your magnetic field, so if I mark this as the Z direction, your electromagnetic wave will be propagating in the positive Z direction. When understood, so your electromagnetic wave will be propagating in the positive Z direction. So that is the case of propagation here. That is how your wave is propagating. And since this E and H are perpendicular, this is a transverse electromagnetic wave, right? So this is the case of TEM, the transverse electromagnetic wave propagating along the line. So you are directing your electromagnetic wave in along this line. So you take the line to wherever you want. Your electromagnetic wave is propagating only in that particular direction. Okay, so that is the understanding that we get. Now, since it is TEM, we have some easier understanding here on the transmission line equations. Okay. So, whenever it is TEM, it means that your E and H are perpendicular to each other. Then only we can relate what? We can relate E with the voltage and H with the current as per our equations that we are aware of. What are those equations? V is given by the negative integral of what? E dot dl, right? And the current I is given by what? As per Gauss's law, it is given by S dot dl, right? So these two relations we can use here. So from now on, we are not trying to solve the transition or write the transition equation in terms of the electric and magnetic field, but in terms of what? Our voltage and current, and in terms of the circuit theory, because it is more simple and more convenient. So let us examine it here, or let us derive it here. So we have given you a transmission line model like this. So the same model, let us say that I am taking a small portion of this like this, and the distance of this thing I am taking as delta Z, and that such a small infinitesimally small distance delta Z, I am making an equivalent circuit. Then I can extrapolate that small equivalent circuit to the transmission line system. So that is what I am doing. So for the small place here, I have resistance, inductance, conductance as well as the capacitance, right? So I am going to draw an equivalent circuit, a small equivalent circuit for this place. Okay. So let us see here. Let us see that here. It is like this. You have your resistance, okay. Then what? Then your inductance as well, right? And here I am making a small change here, that since they are parallel, I am taking it together, and this is what? This is the conductance and this is the capacitance, right? And this is how it is returning. So R resistance here means what? Resistance is per unit length. Per unit length or per ohm per meter, you can say per unit length, what is the resistance of this line? So that into delta Z will give me what? That will give me for delta Z distance, what is the resistance? Similarly, L is what? Per unit length, what is the inductance of the line? L into delta Z will give me the inductance in what? In delta Z length. So similarly, the conductance of the medium between is taken as G, and G in delta Z. Similarly, capacitance is given by what? C into delta Z, where C is given by, it is farad per meter, means per unit length, what is the capacitance of the transmission line. Clear? So this is the transmission line model that we have, and this end, this is where your generator, this from the generator, it is coming, and here it goes to the load. Okay, so that is the direction I am saying, and this is the Z direction, the propagation direction, and the small distance that is happening here, that is what delta Z. Delta Z is the distance of this part, I can say. So let me say, at a particular Z parameter value, I have my voltage here, and that I am giving by V of Z comma T. Why Z comma T? You are aware, because it is varying with respect to length as well as with respect to time. So I am taking it as what? V of ZT, right? Voltage of ZT. And after delta Z section, on the other part of the place, what will be the total voltage? It is given by V of Z plus delta Z, because from Z it has traveled delta Z distance, comma T, right? So that is V of Z plus delta Z, comma T. Similarly, your current passing in this direction, this I am taking as what? I of ZT. And the current on the other part, that I am taking as I of Z plus delta Z comma T. Okay. So similarly, the current that is passing, if this is I, the current that is passing through this conductor part, that I am taking as delta I. Okay. So the conductor, all these parts. So this, let me say this is Z, and this is what? Z plus delta Z. So this is a small equivalent circuit model that we are considering for the small section delta Z. Okay, that means between what? This is, if this is Z direction, between Z and Z plus delta Z, the small portion delta Z we are considering here. So the derivation is quite easier. We are just applying what? First we will apply KVL, then we will apply KCL. Okay, so first let us apply what? KVL. Okay, what is KVL means what? Let us apply KVL for this loop. This loop, we will apply our KVL for this loop. Okay, so if I apply KVL for that loop, what we will have? On the one side we have got V of ZT, right? So that is, let me say that is the potential. V of ZT will be equal to, the current is going through the resistance and inductance on this part, right? The current is going through resistance and inductance in this part, so it will be equal to what? R into delta Z into I of Z comma T, right? Plus what? What is the relationship of voltage and current in an inductor? V is given by L di by dt. Yeah, you are aware. So here, what is inductance? It is L di by dt anyhow. So inductance is what? L into delta Z. And what is the next term? It is di by dt. But here, since your current is varying with respect to the space as well as with respect to time, I am going to use partial differentiation. So dou I of Z comma T divided by dou T. Right. So dou I plus Z comma T divided by dou T plus what? What is the voltage that is coming across this part? The voltage that is coming across this part is what? V of Z plus delta Z T. Z plus delta Z comma T. So that also I can write here. So that is V of Z plus delta Z comma T. So that is the total voltage that you can know here. Now, I want to write it in terms of like dou V by dou T. So for that, I am taking the voltage terms to one side. So as you are aware, you can write it with me. V of Z plus delta Z comma T minus V of Z T if I may. And really, I should for that, I should take it, take this one to this side. But then what? Yeah, this one this side. Then to avoid a negative on the other side, I am using a negative here, divided by delta Z. If I take delta Z from all those parts here, then that will give me, that will be equal to what? R into I of Z comma T. Delta Z has gone to the other part, plus L into dou I of Z T by dot T. So this is the equation for voltage. This V of Z plus delta Z comma T minus V of Z T by delta Z, that is something familiar, and that is equivalent to what the difference you are differentiating voltage. So that will give me what, minus dou V of Z T minus dou V of Z T divided by what, dou Z. By Z to Z, you are differentiating the voltage, which is equal to R into I of Z T plus L into dou I of Z T divided by dou T. Right. So here it is what, dou T, and here it is with respect to Z, and it's a coupled equation you can see. Right. So that is about this. And now similarly on this node here, means what, at this node if you apply the KCL, similarly you will get, you can write it now, or let us write that. If you write the KCL for that, then what you will get, the current entering is what, I of ZT, and the current leaving have got two parts. One is what, I of Z plus delta Z comma T. The other part is the delta I flowing through the parallel branches. So that if I write it down, one part is again what, I of Z plus delta Z comma T. So the parallel branches, what is going, delta I you have to take. One is what, one is to the conductance path. So I can just write G into delta Z, and the voltage between G into V will give you the current, and the voltage between there is what, V of Z plus delta Z comma T. Right, G of Z plus delta Z comma T. So, and plus what, plus capacitance, and capacitance current is related with voltage in which way, C dV by dt. So C delta Z is the capacitance, and dV by dt means what, dou into V of Z plus delta Z comma T divided by what, divided by dou T. So that will give me the total current equation. Now similar way, if we rewrite this equation, then you will get what, minus I of Z plus delta Z comma T, right, minus I of Z comma T, minus I of Z comma T divided by delta Z will be give, will give you G into V of Z plus delta Z comma T plus C into dou V of Z plus delta Z comma T divided by dot. Right, so this this part of the equation again become what, the partial differential. So I can write it as what, dou I of Z comma T, right, dou I of Z comma T divided by dou Z, that is equal to G into V of what, Z comma T I can write. So if we take out delta Z to be infinitesimally small, okay, or first let me take Z plus delta Z into T. Z plus delta Z comma T plus what, C into dou V of Z comma T Z plus delta Z comma T divided by dou T. And now if we apply delta Z tends to 0, then what, then it will become minus, this is minus, is the minus dou I of Z comma T divided by dou Z is equal to G V into Z of T, G V of Z comma T plus C into dou V of Z comma T by dot T. Okay, so that is the equation here. One is in terms of V and another one is in terms of I. So these equations are the, and if we assume that we are, you are already familiar with harmonic fields, right? And if we assume that V of Z comma T is given by what, the real part of what, the phasor Vs of Z into e raised to j omega T, and the current I of Z T is equal to the real part of Is of Z into e raised to j omega T. You are familiar with this thing from the earlier module. So with that understanding, where this Vs of Z and Is of Z, they are the phasor forms. Okay. Now in terms of phasor form, if we write this, then the same equation you can write, minus dVs by dz is given by R plus j omega L, right? You know how it is. When you differentiate, that is how j omega comes into Is, then minus dIs divided by dz will give you g plus j omega c into Vs. So these are the equation. Now again you can see that one place you have Vs and Is in the both equations. So you can take the second derivative. You can take the second derivative of this equation. Then you will get, if you take d square Vs by what d z square, then what it will become r plus j omega l into d is by d z, there, right? This will become r plus j omega l into d is by d z. So that d is by d z is here, and for that I can give this equation. So that will become g plus j omega c into v s, right? So that is d square v s by d z square. So this equation is something familiar with you, and this I can write as d square v s by d z square minus gamma. This or this whole term I am writing as what, gamma square. So gamma square v s equal to 0, right? So this has become, this is something that you are familiar with, this kind of equation. And with that understanding, I can say that this gamma square here, that is what, all the gamma, gamma is equal to alpha plus j beta, and that gamma gamma here, we can understand that it is what, that is the propagation constant gamma. Okay, gamma is given by r plus alpha plus j beta. Gamma is given by alpha plus j beta, which is equal to what, root of r plus j omega into g plus j omega c. So that is about it. Similarly, if you take the current second derivative of current, you will get d square is divided by d z square minus gamma square is equal to 0. Okay, so these are the wave equations, right? You are already familiar with this equation from last module. These are the wave equations for voltage and current in the similar waveform we have taken for the plane waves. So this gamma is the propagation constant, right? The gamma is the propagation constant per meter, and alpha is what, alpha is called as the attenuation constant. Alpha is the attenuation constant, and beta is what, beta is the phase constant. Beta is the phase constant in radians per meter, and alpha is what, in napers per meter or decibel per meter. The wavelength lambda and the wave velocity, they also can be found out. It is similar, you have already learned. Wavelength is given by what, 2 pi by beta, and the velocity is given by omega by beta or f lambda. So these are all common relationships that you know. Now these are what, second derivative, and these are the linear homogeneous differential equations that already you have solved similar equation. And here we can write Vs of z as what, if you solve it, you can write it as V0 plus into e raised to minus gamma z plus V0 minus into e raised to gamma z. You have already learned this, right? This V0 plus term, that is something which goes in the plus positive z direction, and the other one that is going in the what, the minus z direction. Similarly, you can write is of z also in the similar way, I0 plus, right, on one direction it means e raised to minus gamma z plus I0 minus into e raised to gamma z. So both propagating in the different direction. They are the wave amplitude and the sign respectively. Okay. Or if you want to write in terms of what, in phase and time, you can write it as what, the real plot of Vs of z e raised to j omega t. Or if I elaborate it, it will become what, V0 plus e raised to minus alpha z cos of omega t minus beta z plus V0 minus, right, plus V0 minus e raised to alpha z into cos of omega t plus beta z. So that is about the potential. And the characteristic impedance here is an important term, characteristic impedance. The characteristic impedance, that is given by you can write it as Z0, and that is given by what, ratio of the positively traveling voltage wave to the current wave at any point of time. Z0 is given by what, the ratio of the positively traveling voltage wave, positively traveling voltage wave, right? So what, this V0 plus divided by the positively charging current wave I0 plus, it will be also equal to V0 minus by I0 minus also. Okay, that is what, that is the characteristic impedance of this thing at any point on the line. And from earlier understanding, you can write it down as what, Z0 is given by V0 plus by I0 plus equal to V0 minus by I0 minus, that is equal to R plus j omega l divided by gamma, or it is also equal to what, that is about how you derive it, divided by gamma plus gamma by g plus j omegas. Okay, so if you derive that way, then you will get Z0 as what, root of r plus j omega l divided by g plus j omega c. Okay, so this is equal to r0 plus jx0. This is what the characteristic impedance of the line. That is the characteristic impedance of the line. Where your r0 and x0 are what? They are the real and imaginary parts of the z0. And the here you one thing you have to understand is that this r and this r here, that is given in ohm per meter, and this r0 here, that is in ohms. Okay, so that difference you should keep in mind.